set up here over in our Facebook community. And I am live in Fearless Visionary Facebook community. Let me go ahead and invite some people. Hey, Kanisha. Now, Kanisha, I am live over in the Fearless Visionary community too, right? So you're probably going to see a whole lot more interaction that happens over there. But so good to see you. Definitely, if you can, just share it out for me. Let individuals know that we are on live. And tonight we're talking about some amazing things. Hey, ladies, thank you so much for joining. I see you guys coming in. Hey, LaVon, good to see you. Hey, Florida, good to see you, sis. Hey, Ramona. Hey, Dr. Leonora. Yes, good to see you, Kanisha. All right, yes, yeah, so definitely share out. If you can, as you're joining, I want you to take a moment. Hey, Dr. Princess, to just share this out. We want to get as many people on this live stream this evening. I think I like this Friday evening live stream flow. Can you guys hear me okay? Do I need to be a little bit louder? And one of the other things I would love for you guys to do tonight is to make sure that you have a pad, a writing pad, and a pen or a pencil, because we're going to, hey, Valencia, we're going to be sharing a lot of in-depth content tonight while we're talking about identifying the source of a negative self-image, right? So we're talking about the imposter syndrome, something that plagues the lives of women, actually of men too, but for us women, because we internalize so much, then it manifests a whole lot differently for us than what it does for men. Men try to keep theirs under wraps and not say anything about it. Okay, so Kanisha, you have your girls with you. Oh, awesome. Hey, Kennedy. Hey, Brookie. Glad you guys could join us tonight. So we're going to just wait another 30 seconds as you guys go ahead and share this out. If you two could just do a watch party so those that are in your community can basically just watch it live as you're watching it. Hey, Janisha, as you're watching it, then, you know, everyone can kind of get the experience of what's going to happen, what's going to take place on this evening, okay? So glad you guys can make it. How is everybody? Did everybody have a good Friday? Did everybody have a good week? Oh, good, Ramona. Thank you for letting me know. Good. So guys, I am Erica T. Johnson. I am one of the Fearless Visionaries. My mission in life, my mission in the space that I'm in right now is to really disrupt unproductive cycles, right? For high achieving women, for women leaders, to help disrupt unproductive cycles in life as well as in business, right? As you break through, hey Michelle, as you break through insecurities, and then go from invisibility to influence, right? But the key thing is I've been called to be a disruptor, right? A disruptor of complacency, a disruptor of a cycle that continues to manifest in a negative way in your life. So that's why I love to do trainings and talks about this very subject that we're gonna dive into this evening, right? So I do a lot of mindset mastery with women leaders. I've actually created programming that's called Master Your Inner Fraud. And it's dealing with the imposter syndrome. It's dealing with that chronic self-doubt that we as women sometimes struggle with, right? We're dealing with that tonight. So glad you guys can join me. Okay, so Ramona's doing a watch party. Thank you so much, Ramona, for that. All right, so let's get into it, right? We're gonna go ahead and move forward as we're waiting for other ladies to come in. They're just gonna pick up from where we are, okay? So we're gonna go ahead and get into it. So like I said, make sure you have your pad as well as your pencil so that you can just really jot some notes because I believe that something that I'm gonna share this evening is going to be something. Yeah, I don't think you can do a watch party from the page. You would probably have to be on your personal page, Kanisha, and tapped into the Fearless Visionary community in order to do a watch party. So right now you're on Erica T. Johnson Empower. So that's probably why you cannot do it from that page. Hey, Natalie, glad to see you. Okay. So let's just get into it, right? And so we're dealing with self-image. So you may even ask the question as to what is a self-image, okay? So a self-image is a mental blueprint, right? It's a mental blueprint. Hey, Sean, glad to see you, sis. Glad that you can join us. It's a mental blueprint, or it's an internal image that you have of yourself, right? So it's very personal. It's so personal that this is what you've created, right? This is the blueprint. This is the framework that you see yourself and everything that's connected or associated with you. You see it through this blueprint and you see it through this framework. Hey, Jalisha, so glad that you can join us, right? So a self-image is a mental blueprint, or it's an internal image that you have of yourself, okay? So this is key. We are all born with a self-image. And the self-image that we're born with is one that's void of any type of outside influences, negative outside influences, any type of trauma, right? So we basically come here with a blank canvas, a blank framework, right? But it has the potential, or it has a success potential element to it. So we have a blank canvas with the potential to help us succeed. Okay? So it's a blank canvas with the potential to help us succeed. But over time, this is what happens to that canvas. That blank self-image begins to get distorted. And it begins to experience life. And how many of you know that life is not always roses, right? It's not always roses. There are situations and circumstances that oftentimes come up. If you're living and you're breathing, you're going to experience some part of life that does not feel too good. You're going to experience some part of life that causes you to begin to see yourself differently. Okay? So life is going to cause you to see yourself differently, because we've already said that self-image is that mental blueprint, or is that internal picture that you have of yourself. And when life begins to come in and circumstances begin to pop up in your life and you begin to deal with things, even as you're growing up as a kid, then it begins to shape and to form your self-image. So I hope you guys can see how important that is, right? So it's important. Your self-image is important. Everything hinges on your self-image, right? And what happens with that self-image, as life begins to speak to that self-image, then you basically become whatever you believe, because that self-image becomes becomes your belief system. So you begin to believe what you see. You begin to believe what you see, right? You become what you believe. So whatsoever a man thinks in his heart, so is he. You can say hello. Say hi. Okay, I need you to go. Bye-bye. Say hi. Yeah.
My name was Lena Huntington. She took both of them.
She took both of what?
The remote.
Hey, Shayla. Okay, guys, you see I got a visitor. He's always bringing me his problems. And I tell him, can you solve it? You and Elena solve your problems yourself. Okay, Caleb, bye-bye. Nanny Yogi says, hi. Okay, how about this? How about you guys give me a second, okay? I'll be right back. So this is life.
Can you tell Elena to share the remote?
Okay, so tell Elena to come here. And if you can close my door, I would appreciate it. Thank you, sir. All right, so ladies, thank you. That's considered life. I don't have a lock on my office door, so people just kind of come in and out at will, okay? So you might even see him come back again tonight, okay? Awesome. So just you ladies can just give me a thumbs up just to let me know that you guys are still here. I don't see you. So just let me know that you're still here. So basically, what you you become what you believe, right? So that self-image is that it's the foundation or is the root of your belief system. This is gonna be good tonight, y'all. So hopefully, if you guys have come, okay, I'm seeing the thumbs up over on in the community. Thank you, ladies. Hey, Tracy, if you guys have come and you're wondering, okay. You know, do I have a negative self-image? You're wondering, where does it come from? How can I, you know, how can I get rid of that? How can I move beyond that? Then you're in the right place tonight because we're going to be really talking about this. So there's something that I did. Like I told you guys, I get an opportunity because I am a leadership expert. I get an opportunity to train women around the inner fraud is what I call it. I call it your inner fraud, right? Your self-image, your imposter syndrome. I get to train women on this, right? And so I get to see all type of women, okay? So in my practice, I get to, you know, to train and to coach all type of women. Not all of the women look like me, right? But they're all professionals. They're either, you know, they're either some type of business owner. They run some type of company. A lot of times they too are just like professionals, you know, in the workspace. But I get to see these women and I get to hear firsthand beliefs. I get to hear what these women believe. And so one of the things that I did as part of, you know, the training that I, you know, this training program that I have is, you know, before we even get started with just kind of laying the land on this training program, we just do this assessment. And this assessment is really geared towards what is it that you actually believe, right? And you're measuring yourself from a scale to 1 to 10, 1 being, you know, I really don't agree with what you just said, and then 10 being, yes, I'm there, this is a belief, this is what I strongly believe, that sort of thing. But it's amazing to me that, you know, when we first start off the training, most women, you know, on average, they have a score between a 2 and a 4. Right? But then as I began to present to them about the imposter syndrome and where the phenomenon came from and how you can identify it and, you know, what's the lie that's rooted in the imposter syndrome and what is that lie trying to tell you? And then I began to walk through the system that I've designed to help them move away from it. That number goes from the 2 to 4 and it can go anywhere from like a 7 to a 9. Where basically in a matter of us sitting down in a 2 to 3 hour training, they have literally switched their mindset. And so that's why I'm saying if you're here tonight, get ready for a shift in your mindset. That's one of the things that I've accepted about myself is when I somehow I have this thing when I connect with you, I'm going to help you shift. That's why I say, you know, I consider myself to be one who disrupt patterns, right? old patterns that you know that you need to do away with, patterns that no longer serve you. Yes, sir.
Mom, did Elena tell you?
Uh-huh.
What did she say?
No, she didn't come.
What?
Okay, so listen. Can you come back later? Like when Mom calls you? Like when I'm finished with my, because you see my ladies on here? You see the names on here? You see Aunt Regina? You see Pastor Q on here? Look, everybody. Nanny Shayla, Cousin Kanisha. You see that?
Nope.
You see Aunt Florida and Aunt Ramona? Like all of these ladies are listening in live as Mommy's talking.
But can you tell Elena to come?
Okay, so I can't tell Elena anything, but you can go tell Elena to come.
I did, but she didn't listen.
Okay, you see, Dr. Princess, is this what you were talking about earlier in the week? Brookie said hello, Elena. Brookie said hello. And Kanisha and Brookie said hello. Okay, so I need you to leave. Bye-bye. You can only stay if you're not talking. Okay, bye-bye. Or you can get a chair and you can sit and you can listen and you can teach about self-image, okay? All right, close the door, Kayla. All right, so, okay, let's do this, ladies. I have 10 signs, all right? This is 10 signs that you currently have a negative self-image, okay? So get ready to shift is really why I was saying what I was saying earlier, is get ready to shift, get ready to be disrupted in that pattern or that behavior if it's something that you're dealing with, right? If it's something that you're dealing with, get ready to shift. So there's 10 signs that let you know that you have a negative self-image. These are the 10. Number one, right? You have anxiety, you have worry of being found out, okay? You worry if others realize that maybe you're not as intelligent as you are. Maybe you're not as business savvy as you say that you are. Maybe you're not as fearless, as a visionary as you say you are, right? You're constantly worried that someone's gonna find you out, right? You're worried that you're not as put together as you portray, right? So that's one sign that you could be dealing with a negative self-image or the imposter syndrome, whichever one you want to call it, okay? Number two, you believe or you have a belief that you don't deserve it. You see, the thing about a negative self-image, it puts you in a space where although you may experience success after success, and right, and success is something that is individualized, is based on, you know, how you measure reaching a goal or achieving a goal. Success is achieving a goal. So those goals look different for everybody. It's individualized. So what happens with the negative self-image, it's basically gonna put you in a space where you believe, although you have these success and you're reaching these goals, you're gonna believe that you don't deserve it. You're gonna still believe that somehow you're not good enough, right? Kanisha says, so you're feeling guilty. Somehow you're gonna feel that you're still not good enough to experience that success or to receive that recognition. But you showed up, you did the work, you was consistent, you took the punches as they came. You faced the challenges. You experienced all of those things, but yet there's a belief that says you still don't deserve this. That's a negative self-image. Yeah. Number three is you have difficulty accepting praise. That was one that I struggle with that. And actually often, even today, I have to remind myself of this one. Now, the difficulty accepting praise is that, you know, you've done an amazing job. And guess what? Someone comes up to you and they say, oh, you did an absolutely wonderful job. And you're like, oh, it's not a big deal. Like you're going to dumb it down, right? Instead of saying, oh, thank you. I really appreciate you, you know, sharing that with me, right? Instead of you accepting, you know, that praise, you're going to instead dumb it down. And you're going to be like, oh, no, it's, you know, oh, no, it's not a big deal, right? So when someone praises you for a job well done, make sure you're saying thank you, right? You're saying thank you. Are you ladies still here? You're saying thank you. But if you're struggling to say thank you, then a negative self-image is at play. And the thing about the negative self-image, and I'll get a chance to show you guys, you don't really realize that, you really don't realize what's going on. Because it's become so much a part of you. It's ingrained in you and you don't really realize what's going on. And I'm going to show you the reason why in a second. Thank you for the thumbs up. Okay. So number four, the fourth sign that you are dealing with negative self-image, you have a fear of what others think. You're always concerned about what people think about you. Or you, for some reason, may not move out and do something because you're concerned about what they may say, what they may do, right? You know, how will they, you know, how will you be portrayed by them? What is the perception that you know, that they will have of you? But the reality is, that's none of your concern. What people think about you, that's not your concern. Right? The perception is not your concern, only in certain instances. And we're not going to cover those instances tonight. But for the most part, it's not your concern. People are going to talk. People have their own insecurities and their own negative self-image that causes them, you know, sometimes to, you know, to impose that on other people or superimpose that on other people. So that part is not your concern. Yeah. So it's that perception thing of how will people perceive me? You know, you have a fear of what people think of you. Number five, the fifth sign that you have a negative self-image is there's always feelings of inadequacy despite evidence of success, right? Now you have evidence. And you still have a negative self-image, right? And we're told to have faith, which is, you know, the evidence of things hope of the, you know, you hoping for something and you may not even have the evidence of it. But here, when we're actually talking about, you know, success, we see the success, we experience the success, we get the rewards. We experience the recognition, we receive the awards, but yet we still feel like we're inadequate. We feel like we still don't have enough, right? We still feel like although we have this track record, we still don't possess everything that we need in order to succeed, yet we're succeeding. Get a piece of paper.
Can I get a note?
No, you can get a piece of paper and you can take notes as mommy's teaching. So Caleb's going to join us and he's going to take some notes too as we talk about our self-image. Sit there. There you go, buddy. Okay, so there's those feelings of inadequacy, right? Despite the evidence of success. Number six, the sixth sign that you have a negative self-image is that the focus is more on what's not complete. So you're working diligently to get things done, yet you're always focusing on what's not complete. So you can have 98% of a project done, but what you're going to be concerned about is the 2%. That's not complete. Although 98% is done. Right? So that negative self-image. accomplish is going to always have you thinking about, okay, what do you have that's left undone? What T hasn't been crossed? What I hasn't been dotted? Because these are the things that people get a perception of you from.
E-L-E-N-A. Wait, don't do it fast.
E-L-E-N-A.
I got the E.
L.
Sorry.
E-N-A. Elena.
E-N-A. Is that it?
Yeah. So you are looking to dot every I and cross every T. Right, so you're so concerned about that you really forget to celebrate the 98%. And so the focus and anything that you focus on, you're basically magnifying it, right? So that becomes so much of the focus, you basically water down what you are actually able to accomplish, and you're not even been able to celebrate that or be excited about the fact that I'm almost there. I'm at 98%. I got that much done. I only have just a little bit left to go, right? You can't even celebrate that because your focus is on, oh, no. I still got the 2%. I can't celebrate just yet. I can't be excited about this just yet. Instead of setting manageable milestones for yourself where you can celebrate when you've done 25% of it. You like, hey, yeah, I completed 25%. You've done 50% of it. Oh, awesome. I got the 50%. Only half left to go. You got 75% done. Now you're doing the running man because now you got 75% done. And then you got the 100% done. But because we don't set milestones, is either a pass or a fail. And you can be close to that very end, but yet you're not celebrating it. Yeah, so Ramona is saying, I deal with the imposter syndrome when I feel like I should be at mastery, even when I'm just starting, no grace to grow. Oh, listen, can I tell you, I am experiencing one of the most humbling, but one of the most beautiful processes right now. See, something happened as a result of being connected to Fearless Visionaries and, you know, my path and just things just changing. So when I began to look at my professional landscape, I literally went from being someone that basically got work done through everybody else, you know, being a leader in my own right, to now being a global consultant. But it's in a space where I first began my journey, right? And it has now, 18 years has transpired, and I'm going back to the very beginning. And this is a skill set that, you know, I have not been using. So that feels very uncomfortable to have tenure. And I go back into this organization that although I have 18 years tenure, I don't necessarily have the, you know, the skill set at that level of competency as somebody that's just really starting out in that area, right? Or somebody that's been in that area for 5 years. It's like, I'm really like a newbie. So it's an humbling experience, but it's also an experience that I'm enjoying. I'm enjoying the fact that I'm having to be humbled in this way. That means I'm able to grow. That means, okay, I can still one day be a leader in this area because I'm able to be humble. And guess what? I basically voiced to the individuals who are senior, right? Hey, Pastor Quilla, I basically voiced to the individuals that are senior in the organization saying that it feels somewhat kind of strange. And don't you know? It's like God had them just encourage me to say, oh, don't you worry about it. We got your back. You have any questions, just come to us. Ask whatever it is that you need. We're here to support you. We're here to develop you. We're here to give you the assistance that you need. You're trying to get somewhere along the path of technical leadership. We're here to be that force for you. So there's ways to squash that imposter syndrome. And it has a whole lot to do with the people that's around you too, right? Amen. Listen, Florida is saying, you are coachable and mendable to grow to the next level. Yeah, and actually I got that word from Dr. Princess. Be teachable, be coachable, be mendable, and she said be pliable. And I promise you, that word keeps showing up in all of the different areas of my life. It's so amazing. Yes, it's so amazing. Yeah. So let me just say this, ladies, before we move forward. If you have questions, because I know I posted earlier this morning, if you have questions, you know, burning questions around self-image or the imposter syndrome, go ahead and start posting those. And once we get more towards the end, then we're going to start answering some of those questions. I did pick up a question from Instagram that I will address as we're talking here. But if you have a question, a burning question, go ahead and put it in the comments, and I'll make sure I pick that question up, and we can, you know, I can answer it or I can address it some kind of way as we are going through this training, okay? As we're doing this live stream and we're doing this teaching. So we're focusing again tonight on identifying the source of a negative self-image. We will never be able to disrupt or rectify or challenge those negative behaviors or those things that are showing up negatively in our lives if we don't first begin to identify them, right? So we have to identify them. Hey, Darlene. Good to see you, sis. So we have to be able to identify them in order for us to then begin to disrupt them, okay? So that's what we're doing tonight. We're just identifying. I'm not trying to share, you know, the big plan and the big system on, you know, how you tackle it. We're going to just do the very first part where we're talking about how to identify it. Then if you want to, you know, get more in depth, then I have that training already, you know, it's already packaged and ready to go. You can easily go and get that, okay? Awesome. Yes, yes, yes. So Ramona is saying, God has given me favor in this place. H-A-C-K. God has given me favor in this place. I am learning to sit myself down and start where I am. Thanks for this training. You are welcome, Ramona. Yep. Like Dr. Princess says, sit yourself down. Yep. Learning to sit yourself down and start right exactly where you are. That's awesome. Pastor Q says, squash the imposter syndrome. That's right. Tanisha said, I needed this. Yes. All right. So, ladies, what number did I leave off on? I think I gave you 1 through 5, where it's 10 signs that you are suffering with a negative self-image. Number 1 being anxiety or worry of being found out. Number 2 was believe you don't deserve it. Number 3 was difficulty accepting praise. Number 4 is fear of what others think. Number 5 is feelings of inadequacy despite evidence of success. So number 6. Oh, and number 6 was focus more on what's not complete. So let me give you these last, let me give you 7, 8, 9, and 10, these last 4, because I want to get to as well just kind of talking about what self-image actually looks like, okay? So number 7, you say the words, I'm a fraud, I'm a fake. That's your belief. I am a fraud, I am a fake. If people really knew I'm not as good as I say I am, if people really knew I'm not making as much money as they would think that I'm making in my business, if people really knew that although I got this big platform, I really don't have that much influence. If people really knew, so you're constantly, you know, you're saying to yourself, I'm a fraud, I'm a fake, right? Again, it's based on, you know, negative thoughts of yourself, right? And your self-image, you're lacking confidence, right? You're lacking confidence. Number 8, self-doubt. That's what the imposter syndrome is. It's chronic self-doubt, not just self-doubt, but chronic self-doubt. Statistically, all of these psychological studies have been done over the years, starting years back. And it's amazing that even still today, 70% of people who are successful deal with the imposter syndrome. I'm talking about men. I'm talking about women. 70%. Isn't that amazing? 70% of people that you would look at and you would consider them to be successful, you would consider them to be at the top of their game, you would consider them to be dominating in their industry, they're dealing with the imposter syndrome. Now, isn't that amazing? But this is what's interesting about it, is like that imposter syndrome, that negative self-image will only let you go so far. So just think about it. They're probably at the top of their game, but think about if they took the time to really deal with what's eating them on the inside, how much further they could go, how much wider their reach can be, right? How much larger their territory and their capacity could be if they took the time to really deal with what's eating them. Because the reality is, when it comes to your self-image, the reality is we build that not from the outside in, right? We can't just put all beautiful red lipstick on it and nice little earrings and, you know, lay a lace frontal or anything on it. You basically got to build it from the inside out. You get that? So when it comes to the self-image, it's not based on the outside, you know, the facade that we put up, because most of us catfish people all day. That's what a negative self-image is going to cause you to do. A negative self-image is going to cause you to catfish folks all day, right? Because they're seeing one thing. And they're thinking, oh my goodness, you know, this is what I see. This is, oh my goodness, I know this person, but they're really just getting catfished. And if you guys have actually seen that show, you know, you have folks that are, you know, and a lot of times they're connecting with people a lot of times online, and they're thinking the people, you know, are one way, and they somehow, you know, get in relationship, whether it's a friendship, whether they figure that they're dating these people. And when they go to meet these people, they're not really who they say they are. So we end up the imposter syndrome, and a negative self-image causes you to catfish the people in your circle. So you're fooling people, right? You're playing make-believe with the people because you have yet to deal with the inside. It's internal. So this is always an internal game. It's never something that we're trying to beautify on the outside, because you can wear all of the beautiful clothes that you like. You can have all of these banging colors. You know, your hair can be cute all day long. You know, you can always have that face beat all day long. But none of that matters if yet you still have that shaky foundation that's internal. You ladies get what I'm saying? Yeah. It's kind of shaky because you're not spending the time that you need to build from the bottom up instead of building from the top down. You got to have that firm foundation. It has to be stabilized. It has to be stable. So it's more important for you to spend your quiet time dealing with yourself internally than it is for you to be chasing a platform, right? And trying to build a brand, and yet there's still so much on the inside of you that you need to deal with. Because if you fail to deal with it, everything that you build, when a wind really comes and blows really, really hard, or a wave really, you know, rushes up to the shore, it's going to cause it to crumble because you didn't take the time to build it from the inside out. You were more concerned about, you know, what others had to say about it and why it was so important for you to go ahead and put yourself out there, you know, to get out on social media so that you can be, you know, the influencer or whatever it may be. So we really need to think about that, right? We need to think about that. And so what I'm seeing is counter to what society tells you. Society tells you to be concerned about the outside. Be concerned about your brand, but your brand goes so much further. And that's when I work with my clients on business branding. It's not about your pretty logos and having your colors and your letters just right when you're putting it on a website. It has everything to do with what you value. It has everything to do with what you stand for. It has everything to do with you being self-aware and understanding, you know, how you show up and where are the places that you have the most strength in. And instinctively, when things go on, what's going to be your mode of operation? How are you going to operate? That's a part of your branding. Right? That's a part of your branding. But that's counter to what society tells you. So we need to be more concerned about the invisible than we are what's visible. Because it's the invisible at the end of the day that's going to control everything. I'm going to show you guys that in a second here. Okay. Right? So move past the superficial and the shallow, and let's really start dealing with the condition that we're in. Let's really start dealing with that internal condition that we're in. Yeah, Pastor Q says, when it's under pressure, it will crumble. That's it. Yolanda says, Rochelle said, it's important to have a strong internal foundation. Yes, it does. Okay? Whew. All right, so number 9. So we said number 8 was self-doubt, right? And so number 9, we only got 2 more ladies, and then I'm going to show you guys this picture. Yeah. Yeah. Number 9 is your self-imposed limitations. You remember I was talking about your negative self-image? Your self-image is designed to carry you. So when it's weighted down and it's negative, and the framework in which you see everything through is negative, guess what? You can only go so far as your self-image will allow you to go. That's why opportunities will come to you, and if your image is negative, your self-image is negative, you're going to sabotage it. I can't tell you the number of times I did that. Woo! I cannot tell you the number of times opportunities, good opportunities came. And there was some excuse that kept me from getting to where I needed to get to make that opportunity happen, right? So that's what a negative self-image has the ability to do, right? That's a sign that you have a negative self-image. And then number 10, this is one that, you know, a lot of women and I connect on this one particular issue, and it's having wavering confidence, right? Your confidence wavered. Your confidence is built on, you know, the wind comes, it's gonna move, it's gonna shake, right? It's not steady, it's not firm, it's not rooted, right? It's not rooted. So a wavering confidence is very, very much indicative of you having a negative self-image, right? Because of your stifled belief, you refuse to take action. And I see confidence always as an action word. Confidence to me is an action word. It's you taking action regardless of the fact that, you know, fear may be telling you, no, you can't do it. Fear might be saying, oh, girl, if you show up, you know they're going to laugh at you, right? But confidence is going to say, despite the fear, I'm still going to do this thing. But when you're so stuck by fear, and I say fear is, what do I say, Rochelle? I know I say it all the time when it comes to fear. You're fully expecting and anticipating resistance. That's what fear is to me. Fully expecting and anticipating resistance. And anything that you expect, any place you place your expectation and your intention on, is going to manifest. Right? Your expectation is going to cause that thing to manifest. So guess what? Fear is going to continue to manifest fear if you don't take a step and show, okay, I'm going to walk up my confidence. I'm going to take a step despite what I'm expecting. Okay? All right, so number 7, I'm a fraud on faith. Number 8 was self-doubt. Number 9 was self-imposed limitations. And then number 10 was wavering confidence or a lack thereof. Okay? So there's something that's interesting. So that was the 10 signs, ladies, that you may have a negative self-image. So if any of that resonated with anybody, so I gave you 10. If you can just type in the comment section how many of those you can identify with. Somebody may say, I don't identify with any of them. Congratulations. But I can't say the same. I know what my struggle has been. So I covered 10. If you ladies don't mind, just put it in the comments so that we can just have a for real candid discussion and dialogue. Put that there for me. That's one thing that we have to learn. In this community, in the Fearless Visionary community, we're real, right? In the Fearless Visionaries community, it's about us being real. We're going to tell the truth because we understand the only way that we can be healed. And for those of you that were here last Friday, y'all. Those of y'all that were here last Friday, I said the only way that you can heal is what? If you pursue your healing. So that means you got to tell the truth. You'll only pursue something when you've actually recognized it. So let's see who can tell the truth. So Kanisha said me. Okay, Kanisha, how many is me? Oh, she said at least 3 or 4. All right, that's real. That's real, sis. Dr. Leonora says 10. I gotcha. Rochelle says 6. Okay. Miss Ramona says 8. How many you say, Kayla?
Million.
So Ramona says, you must muster up enough confidence to get you through the door. Then you start shaking once you take a few steps across the threshold under the weight of your fears. Come on here, girl. Doubts and negative thoughts. Come on here. She's talking about confidence. Yeah, this may show up in some areas and not all. That's so true. It's so true. Because you may, in one area, you might be fully, you know, fully confident and have an incredible self-image. But in another area, it may be challenged, right? So you may have, an incredible self-image in one thing and not in another one, you have to do a little bit more work. But I want you to also recognize and realize this. And I had a coach one time who would always say this, and I didn't fully get an understanding of what she meant until, the light popped on for me, right? And so I say this oftentimes, you are the same person that shows up everywhere. So you can kind of mask yourself in a relationship, but you're going to show up at work the same way. You know what I'm saying? So you can't, I'm boisterous and loud over here. Yay. But then I go over here, I'm quiet and meek. You're going to only be able to do the fake for so long before you really get found out. Now, I'm talking about real fake. I'm not talking about, imposter syndrome fake. I'm talking about real fake. Real fake in the sense that you are the same person wherever you show up. So you can get rid of, trying to pretend, because you can only pretend for so long. And then a situation happens, and then, oh, there we go. That's just like you, okay, this is the example that came to mind, so don't judge me, okay? That's like maybe you a person who loves to curse, all right? You're a person that curses. But when you go around certain people, girl, no, I don't curse. Ooh, did you hear what they said? Oh, girl, no. But let something happen, right? Let something pop off. What happened? The first thing that come out of your mouth is who you really are. I don't know why that example came up, y'all, but it did. So you can only mask who you really are for a little while, guys. Before you forget that you're putting on a show. And you gotta correct that. All right. So y'all see how I kind of jumped off course a little bit, but I had to put that one in. You're the same person no matter where you show up, but your confidence can show up at different levels, all right? Your self-image is going to be the same. Your confidence can show up at different levels. Yeah. Dr. Lenora said, yes, that's what we have to remember. We are the same person at all times. Ramona says, usually we are perfect in our rut and what we've mastered and can do in our sleep where you are not growing. Yep. Sister Lenore, Florida says yes, because saying that the word just slipped out. We know better. Yeah, you know you cuss. You a cussing saint. That's what you are. All right. So, that's so funny to me, y'all. All right. So this is the thing. Okay. Can you guys see this? So what I was trying to do, I was honestly trying to just display it on the screen. Can y'all see this? How about now? Is that a little bit better? Right? So this is basically a picture of what your self-image looks like, right? So if you notice, there we go. That's a little bit better. So if you notice, you got 10% that's up here, right? That's conscious. You're aware of it, right? This is what we're aware of. This is what we're aware in terms of our thoughts and our behaviors. But guess what happens? 90% of it is what's subconscious. It's the part that we don't see, right? So when you think about your behavior and you think about how you show up in the world, that usually happens up here at the 10%. But it's being guided by what's happening down here in the iceberg, that 90%. So that 10% is the show a lot of times that we put on, right? It's the cute makeup. It's the cute shoes, right? It's the, you know, the beautiful red bottoms. It's our willpower. Like, we're going to will something to be done. It's our efforts. It's what we say, okay, how we're going to show up. It's, you know, the beautiful smile that we put on, you know, with our white teeth, girl, and, you know, all of that good stuff. It's, you know, the lashes that we put on. It's how we make ourselves up, right? It's the cute little hairstyle. We got sew-ins. You know, we got, you know, Malaysian hair. You know, we got the nice wigs and things like that. It's our presence. But that is all at the end of the day being guided by that 90%, which operates everything. Because that's the part you're not going to see. It's just going to manifest. And you're not going to really understand why you deal with certain situations the way that you do. Right? You're not going to understand why, you know, your best friend is at the top of her game and she's doing well. And instead of you celebrating with her, you have a little sting of jealousy on trying to figure out why, you know, why that's not happening for you. It's happening for her. But you know what? I've been working hard too. It should happen for me as well. Right? So that's that 90%. That you don't see. It's buried deep. And that's what our self-image is. It's buried deep. Right? That's years of programming that's dictating our thoughts and our behaviors. It's acting really like the puppet. It's what's pulling our strings at the end of the day that we don't even realize. We can't even identify that. So that's why we're disrupting some cycles tonight. Right? That's why we're disrupting what has been usual to you. That's why we're going to disrupt you. You know, you start being successful, you experience success, and all of a sudden something happens. That's connected to what your framework that you're using to carry everything with. And if that framework doesn't have the right programming, at some point it's just going to start shutting down. And it's going to start killing those opportunities. And then you're going to start, you know, killing people with your words. And, you know, you're going to start experiencing these behaviors that you're like, wait a minute, hold on, I don't understand this. You want to do right. You want to uplift. You want to support. But instead, you got all these, you got this internal war and battle that is going on that you don't quite understand, but it's coming from a negative self-image. Does that make sense? Yes, that's your subconscious programming. That's right, Andrea. Yeah. Exactly. So this is the thing. So let's get to really so that self-image, that 90%, that's your belief system, y'all. That's what we're believing. And this is how it manifests in the actions and the words, right? How we show up. But this 90% is what's controlling us. So your self-image is created by three things. So we're talking about the source of it now. So make sure you ladies, you got your pen, you got your pad. We're going to hit this. Yeah. So your self-image is created, number one, by your exposures. Your exposures. I'm going to take me a little sip of water while y'all write that down. Your exposures. So let's think about exposures for a second. And this is the part, ladies, that I really want you just to take the blinders off, right? This is the moment that you just need to be really serious and really truthful about this. Because what I'm asking is, you have your piece of paper. I'm asking for you to write down, as I'm talking about this, what's coming to you. And so I speak right now that whatever is hindering you must be released right now as we begin to talk about this. I'm speaking and releasing right now that whatever is holding you back and holding you down gets disrupted tonight. Because last week we talked about, as women, we are gatekeepers of legacy. And because we're those gatekeepers of legacy, it's important for us to take that time to focus in on us so that we're making sure that there is nothing that is blocking the gateway. That when it's time to start releasing others, and when it's time for you to start helping others to grow, and when it's time for you to step into your role fully as a leader and as an influencer, there is nothing that is holding you down. Because you can imagine how much weight is down here in the 90%, right? You're going to try to float to the top, but it's going to bring you down. You're going to try to get up, but it's going to bring you down. You're going to try to be excited for other people, but that negative self-image is going to bring you down. Okay? So we want to get rid of the weight. Yeah. We want to get rid of the weight. So your exposures. This one is really simple. Like, we experience it every single day. Like, we're on live stream right now. Could that be a gateway for an exposure? Yep. A lot of us have cell phones, and we have news apps, right? And we have notifications on while we're sitting, we're driving, or we're sitting, you know, having a conversation with our friend. Guess what happens? Something pops up on the screen and it's telling us, you know, this is what's happening right now. You know, such and such said this, right? So we're talking about news. We're talking about social media. Just about every one of us probably have more than one social media account. Hey, Yolanda, good to see you. We probably got the Instagram. Yep, I got the Instagram. We got the Facebook. Yep, I got two of the Facebooks. We're talking about the Twitter. Yep, I got the Twitter. We're talking about YouTube. Yep, I got the YouTube. Periscope, I got the Periscope. LinkedIn, I got the LinkedIn, right? So we have so many opportunities to be exposed to things. So your exposures create your self-image. And you can hear that I didn't say negative self-image. I said self-image, whether negative or positive. And I'm going to tell you the difference there. right? So you've got, you have exposures. What we have the ability, what has the ability to speak to us? What has the ability to get our attention? And as and if you notice, when it comes to media, and I do the same thing because I do a style of writing that's, you know, that's for purposes of marketing, is we use the right language, right? You're going to see the headlines is going to be a bite size, and the headlines is going to draw you in, right? There's going to be something that's said in the headline that says, wait a minute, hold up, let me click this. It's just like, you know, the conversation that we had last week. What was the headline around that one? It was three ways to overcome the effects or the pain of sexual assault. It's wording, it's language that's used and designed to attract you, to cause the curiosity to be sparked, right? To get in your head. Sometimes it can be the using the words that we're already using that makes somebody say, oh, I need to click this article and read this article because I was just saying yesterday that this is what I was struggling with, right? So we have a whole lot of exposure. Andrea says too much exposure sometimes too early in age, right? Because we already said your self-image, when you come here, you have a self-image and it's a clean slate, it's clear. But as you begin to grow and experience life, and one of those areas of life is exposure, that impacts your self-image, okay? So I want you ladies to think about, what are some of the exposures that you're having today that's impacting your self-image, the way that you see yourself, right? For one, think about just this entire project with Fearless Visionaries and women telling their deep personal stories, you know, an exposure could be, you know, you're saying, oh, wow, you know, if I share this, someone's going to victim shame me. Well, guess what? Where did I get that from? I probably was on media some kind of way and saw, you know, someone trying to come out and tell their story. And then what happened? Everybody begins to speak against that person instead of, you know, dealing with, you know, the one that's perpetrated the crime. Instead, they're dealing with the person that was victimized some type of way. Right? So that's what exposure can do to you, right? Where it keeps you, you know, in a certain place, or it brings you to a certain place. All right, so number two is environment. So one of the other items that create your self-image, whether good or bad, is your environment. It's your surroundings. For me, I like to say it's where you grew up, how you grew up. What did you see in your neighborhood where you grew up? I love Dr. Leonora's story where she talks about, you know, in her neighborhood, how she grew up, right? And she saw poverty and she saw crime and, you know, she saw, you know, someone being killed and those sort of things. It's like, what is it that you see in your surroundings? Right? That shapes your self-image. And this is a really big one. It's your influences. And I want you to look at influences from the perspective as well, not only as your environment, right? And the people that you see in the surroundings, but also look at your influences as the leadership that you've been under, right? So you're looking at your parents. How did your parents train you? How did they, you know, train you to grow up? What are the things that, you know, that you saw them do? You know, how did you learn from them? Whether they verbally, you know, shared this training with you, or you just saw them do something. How did they handle situations? How did they handle confrontation? You know, did they have conversations? Like, all of this shapes your self-image, right? How did mom deal with men? How did dad deal with women? All of these things are a part of, or they contribute to your self-image. but also, you know, culture. What's the culture that you grew up in? That's going to affect your self-image too, right? If you grew up in a culture like I grew up, it was you are to be seen and not heard. So that was constantly putting the impression on me that as a female, I didn't have a voice. That what I had to say didn't matter, right? By, oh, you're to be seen and you're not to be heard. That, I mean, that honestly comes down from the slave mentality that a lot of us that are in diaspora, right? That's what came through the slave mentality. You're to be seen and not to be heard, right? So you're looking at culture. You're looking at your other authority figures. You're looking at your teachers, because remember, your self-image is being built or created even as a kid. As a baby, your self-image is being created. As a little girl at 3 years old, your self-image is being created. I think science tells us by the age of 7, you actually have your framework. So think about the people that are contributing to your initial framework. All of those people, your family, your friends, the people that are closest to you, that's impacting your self-image. Other authority figures, teachers, mentors, people that speak it into your life, people that you follow, your pastors and leadership, your spiritual leaders at church, that's impacting your self-image because it's teaching you how to think. It's teaching you how to behave. It's teaching you how to respond. And that is all coming from self-image, okay? So think about that. Think about that, ladies. Just take a moment just to write down, what are the environments that have impacted or had a huge impact on your self-image? Dr. Lenora says environment plays an effect on people, but have to be strong enough to break free. It sure does. And we see it so many times, right? We're examples of growing up in environments that may not have been the most conducive for success, but, you know, because we had a mindset or we had the ability to begin to change programming, right? We tapped into something that allows us to change the programming that, you know, we're able now to see a different type of success. And we were able to elevate from where we grew up, you know, where we grew up. That did not define us. It allowed us to elevate, right? We didn't look at it as, oh, this happened to me. No, we looked at, oh, it's happening, or it happened through me. So we changed the perspective even on the environment that we grew up in. Hey, LaVon, good to see you, sis. All right. So number one was your exposures, and hopefully you wrote down something. And you ladies can capture those things in the comments if there's something that you just want to share with the community. Excuse me. And then the other one was environment. And so the third one, the last one that impacts and affects your self-image, what do you guys think it is? I'll give you guys a second to type in the comments. What do you think that third one is? So if the first one was exposure, the second one was environment, the third one has to be what? Just guess. Okay, yeah, LaVon, you can go back and watch the replay of the first half. Nobody's brave enough to guess? Okay. Ramona says internal thought and chatter. Okay, what are some other thoughts that come to mind? This one is really simple. It's what brought us together as fearless visionaries. So the third one is actually our experiences, y'all. The things that we personally experience and the things that we experience, but through people that we know and love, right? People we know, like, love, trust, all of that. It's the experiences. The experiences are constantly shaping your behavior that is being driven by that subconscious part of you that nobody sees, right? It's your experiences, yeah. And trauma is a part of the experience, right? Because that experience can be just about anything. I know a lot of times, like I like to deal with like money blocks and financial blocks, because, you know, growing up in poverty, you know, one of the things that I set out for myself is I'm gonna keep myself open to the opportunity of monetizing, right? How can I take what I know and monetize that? So that means a whole lot of times I'm working on financial blocks, or what are called money blocks, right? And those too are shaped by your experiences. So don't you know, a block is created when you go into a store and say, for instance, you take out your debit card and you swipe your debit card, and you're in the grocery line and you got $100 worth of grocery that, you know, that you're shopping for. Hey, Nikki, glad to see you. And you swipe your card and the cashier says, oh, ma'am, I'm sorry, can you swipe it again? It was declined. And so you swipe it again and she said, oh, do you have another card? That one doesn't work. Don't you know instantly a block is created because of the humiliation that came along with the fact that you swiped your card and it was declined? Because no one ever gets to hear that, oh no, I actually got money in my account, but it's just a strip on the back of my card that is a bit worn out. Nobody gets to hear that. You just experience the embarrassment and the humiliation that came along with the fact that you're standing in line and there's three other people in line behind you, you know, that have families, and you were just standing there talking to this one lady, and now, you know, you got $100 worth of food, your kids are standing right there with you, and they say your card is declined. That's an experience. And so experiences are a huge contributor to your self-image. So those experiences can come in the form of humiliation and embarrassment. It can come in the form of your successes, the things that you accomplish. So you're attached, you know, say for instance, you accomplish this thing and, you know, you have this feeling. And so you begin to attach this feeling, you know, to this particular success. So whenever you have this particular success, you have this same feeling that happens. And it's the same way on the negative side. Every time then you go into the store, you always have, oh my goodness, well, maybe I should just go and get cash first and just use cash to check out, because I don't want to have that situation again when I swipe my card and a card says decline and I'm in front of all of these people and I feel bad about it and I feel humiliated. So you think about humiliations, you think about your successes, you think about your failures. All of those things are shaped, the things that you triumph over and you overcome, all of those things shape your self-image, right? Because it's all a part of that belief system. It's all a part of that. So the three things that basically create your self-image, and let me just also say, because I did mention when it came to your experience, it was the things that you experienced personally, but maybe what if you saw a friend going through something? And that thing was it deeply affected your friend to the point where now it really affected you, right? That's an experience, right? That's an experience to have. That's like me having a conversation with someone that has a sister that also have been through sexual assault. And, you know, they were deeply, you know, wounded by the fact that they couldn't help their sister get through the sexual assault. That's a personal experience for them as well. There's now emotions that's attached to this particular thing. And those emotions is what's going to continue to come up when a similar situation happens, right? Unless some way they reprogram or reframe the experience is what we're going to say. Okay. Yes. And so just to recap, so the three things that create your self-image is your exposures, your environments, and your experiences. And so, ladies, I want you to go ahead and make sure if you have any questions, you go ahead and you put those in the comments, because we're going to go through those. I think I saw, Florida, you had a question. Looks like I may have lost it. It may have been buried. So, sis, if you can post that question again, that would be so helpful. All right? So, basically, what determines if your self-image is negative or positive is simply the experiences that you have, the things that you are exposed to, and the environment that you are in. If all of those things are positive, guess what? Your self-image will tend to be more positive. If those things are a bit negative, or you haven't dealt with some of those things in one of the categories, then that's going to continue to show up, right? Because this is one of the things when I was talking to my therapist, one of the things that she said that just was like a light bulb moment for me, she said, we frequently are challenged with trauma. We frequently go through trauma. She said, in everyday life, trauma comes up. Right? And she said, literally, trauma, we don't have to make it like this really big thing. Trauma is basically an event that you experience that's literally, it causes high levels of stress in you. And that high levels of stress is really individualized, right? For somebody like me, like I have a high threshold when it comes to managing stress, right? Somebody else, where I've been through some of the things that I've been through, they probably would say to me, oh girl, no, there's no way I would have been able to went through what you went through and still be sane, right? So trauma is even different for us. And our ability to manage stress is different from person to person, right? So she said, we're experiencing trauma every single day. In our experiences, what's important is understanding how do you manage that trauma, because it's going to continue to show up. Okay? So that was a light bulb moment for me, right? So we said, what determines if your self-image is positive or negative are those three sources that we talked about, right? So your self-image has complete control over an individual's ability to achieve or fail to achieve a goal. So that's why I said when we come into our world, the world, our self-image is blank, except for it has the potential to succeed or to help you succeed, right? That's that part of you that's been designed with this mandate to go forth and to reproduce and to manifest and to duplicate yourself in the earth, right? So successfulness hinges on what you believe about yourself. So what you believe about yourself determines your success. That's why self-image is so important. When we're going out here and we're doing anything, we're trying to create a movement as we're doing with Fearless Visionaries. We are starting a business. We're writing a book. All of those things, it's important for us to make sure that we're dealing with our self-image. Because that's what's going to start chattering. That's what's going to start talking. When you're trying to be successful and you're trying to produce something, that negative self-image is what's going to, it's going to talk you down if you're not mindful of it. If somehow you don't tell it to be quiet, it's going to talk you down. If somehow you decide to not deal with it, it's going to talk you down. So it's very much important for you to deal with the negative self-image. And you have to constantly be dealing with this, right? Once you get it all cleaned up, then you have to make sure that you're on the offense, you know, the offense, instead of just totally always being on the defense, like you are, you know, you're taking the position of, you know, I'm going to be proactive about this thing and I'm going to guard my self-image. Maybe I don't expose myself to social media for 10 hours a day. You know, maybe, you know, I choose now who comes into my environment. Maybe I don't associate, you know, with, you know, this particular I associate with this particular friend, the entire conversation, all she wants to do is gossip, right? So then you begin to put safeguards and boundaries in place. And then maybe you begin to be mindful of the experiences that start showing up for you, and you begin to choose as they show up for you instead of festering on them and starting to worry and stressing out about them. You right then and there take care of them, right? So we got to be conscious and we got to be mindful of that, right? You will always sabotage when you operate from a negative self-image. You're going to miss the opportunity, or there's going to be an opportunity there, but because your self-image is negative, you're going to screw it up. You're going to mess it up. You're going to sabotage. That's just basically what's going to happen, because you're working out of that framework that at the end of the day can't serve you, or is going to keep serving you all of the wrong things till one day you just get to a point and you're like, okay, I got to do better. Something has to change. Something has to shake loose here, right? Something has to shake loose here. So let's just start going through some questions. So I had a question that was over in Instagram that said something to the effect of, did I see that those who suffer most when it comes to women, those who suffer most, are they Black women, right? So that was a question. Do you see where, you know, Black women suffer with the imposter syndrome or the negative self-image in other races? And I felt like that was a really good question. And I was so very thankful that I've gotten the opportunity now to work with all type of women, okay? That's the cool thing about being global and not just saying, you know, I'm just only here for just this small group of people. Like, I know I've been called to women in leadership. And so women in leadership look different, right? I've had, you know, I've had clients and women that I've mentored and worked with that are my Caucasian sisters. I have some women that are, you know, high-level executive-level women, some of them that are professional women. Some that, you know, are in careers like I'm in, like in engineering and in technology. You know, I've had women also that have been in ministry, and even pastors, right? Leaders, spiritual leaders of churches that I've actually had the opportunity, you know, to mentor and to work with. So I get an opportunity to see all kinds of women. You know, I've mentored and trained women that are of Asian descent. Are Asian American women that are from, and I know India is a part of Asia, but even women from India, women from the Middle East. I've gotten an opportunity to train with those type of women, women of European descent, women who live somewhere in Europe, right? So I've gotten an opportunity to see all type of women in different settings, but the one thing that is so clear and resonant across the board. Okay, no. Give me a second, okay? Let me make this point. No, can you give me a second and let me finish this, sir? So what I've seen, see, I'm about to get somebody here. Can you close the door, Kayla? So what I've seen across the board is not limited, guys. It's not limited to just one race of women, right? I've had the opportunity to be in a room with nothing but Caucasian women, almost 400 Caucasian women. Don't you know, at the end of me teaching and training and mentoring these women, all of the women that came up, and I mean from the different age groups, I had some women that were in their 60s that were managing companies that came up to me and said, oh, wow, Erica, listen, I wish I would have known you when I was 25. It would have saved me a lot of heartache and heartburn. As I talked about the imposter syndrome, as I talked about confidence and, you know, how you can boost your confidence and even, you know, experiencing a lack of confidence, it's not specific to a race. When I went into Silicon Valley last year and I spoke into a room full of women that were in technology, right? That were from all kind of descents. Actually, I didn't see many women that looked like me in the room. At the end of the training, and it was time for Q&A, the line was so long, it stretched from the front of the room to the back, and there were so many questions that literally they put me out the room, and they told the ladies, listen, this other session has to get started. If you have questions, you need to go outside and talk to her about these questions. So it's not limited just to women who are of African descent. It's not. I'm sorry. Women, we're dealing with the negative self-image. And it shows up, like it manifests, like there's things that happen, you know, that, you know, may have even happened in your culture and in your bloodline, you know, in your mind. Like we're being trained. And if your mom had a negative self-image, you're being trained by your mother subconsciously to also have a negative self-image. Now that's the reality. Because you're picking up cues from the things that she's doing. You're picking up cues from the things that she's saying, okay? So that was that question. Do we have any other questions? Florida, you may have jumped off. I'm not sure, sis, but I can't see your question now. It looks like it may be too far up in the feed where it's not allowing me to go back. Yep, you got to renounce the negative thoughts. You're right about that, Levon. Yes, it's definitely warfare. Safeguards and boundaries protect you. Absolutely. The sabotage, to deliberately destroy, damage, or obstruct something, especially for political or military advantage. Girl, come on. That sounds like a governmental term to me. Pastor Q, did you hear that definition of sabotage? That sounds like a kingdom term to me. Yeah, yeah. So LaVon says, I saw an episode from the Handmaid's Tale, and it was actually too much for me. It dealt with sexual abuse of women. The women were of different nationalities. Yeah, like the atrocities that we're seeing, things that are actually happening, like we can't just pinpoint it to just one particular group of women. It's basically women as a whole. It's the woman as a whole that are dealing with these things, okay? So we frequently, so we got to be mindful of the perspective, because perspective is everything. That's what we have to realize. Perspective is everything. So it was always God's intention for us to see a reflection of himself in us, so that when we looked at ourselves and what we believed about ourselves was rooted in what, you know, what he put in us. And not the other way around, right? But life came in and it began to distort everything, right? And so what's important for us to know is to know that we were born to rule the world rather than the world wreaking havoc on every area of our lives, right? So your self-image was always to be rooted in what God said about you and not what the circumstances and the situation say. Yes. All right, ladies, so let's just do a really real high level, real quick recap, and then I'm going to let you ladies go for the night. You have been so amazing to just hang out with your girl for an hour and a half as we just did this training. I felt like it was so necessary on just how to identify the source of a negative self-image, right? So we said that there's 10 signs. Those 10 signs are anxiety, worry of being found out. Number 2, belief that you don't deserve it. Number 3, difficulty accepting praise. Number 4, fear of what others think. Number 5, feelings of inadequacy despite evidence of success. Number 6, you're focusing more on what's not complete. Number 7, you have the saying, I'm afraid, I'm a fake, they're going to find me out. Number 8, self-doubt. Number 9, self-imposed limitations. Number 10, you have wavering confidence or the lack thereof. And then your self-image is created by 3 sources. It is your exposures, it's media, it's the things that, you know, that touch you, that notify, that catch your attention, that grabs your attention, that builds your self-image. It's your environment, it's your surroundings, the things that are around you, your influences, the things that you touch, the people that speak into your life, the people that are in your circle, and then it's your experiences, what you go through, what you experience on a personal note, the trauma, even, you know, that impacts you as well. Sometimes it's a deep, deep impact where you got to do a lot of work to unearth it, right? But also, the, you know, when you see your best friends going through things, right, that as well impacts you, right? That impacts and that shapes your experiences. And so I want to thank you ladies for joining us on tonight. Thank you all for being an incredible support of Fearless Visionaries Tear the Veil. If you have not purchased your book just yet, I want you to make sure that you go to fearlessvisionaries.com. It'll lead you to our Amazon page where you too can get both volumes 1 and 2 of Fearless Visionaries, to hear from 19 incredible women that walk you through the atrocities that have happened in their life and how they dealt with them and how now they're coming out on the other side. And so also, if you guys are in the Atlanta, Georgia area on June the 22nd, we're going to have our U.S. launch that is taking place in Atlanta, an incredible retreat by Fearless Visionary Sister Yolanda Dupree, such an amazing woman who has a heart to serve. She's going to be doing a retreat for the women on the 22nd that morning called Write the Vision. You're going to have time to kind of tap into that. And then that evening, starting at 6 p.m., I think, or 6:30 p.m., is where you're going to actually have the red carpet event. And so that's going to be amazing. We're going to be dressing to impress. So we're coming with our evening gowns and our tuxedos, and we're going to have an amazing time. And so if you are interested in participating in that, go to dupreegroup.org, and you can grab your ticket for the retreat as well as the actual red carpet lunch that is happening. And just go to our website in general, fearlessvisionaries.com. You will get a list of events that's taking place. We have such amazing events that's still happening here for the rest of the year in New Jersey, in New York, in St. Louis, in Canada, and as well as in Dubai. And so we would love to see you guys there. So thank you. I really appreciate you ladies. If you can do me one last favor as we are signing off tonight, can you just share this? If you know someone that would really benefit from this information that we shared on tonight, can you just share it out? Can you just say, hey, sis, I thought you might like this. Post it in your community. Let people know about the amazing things that's happening in the Fearless Visionary community, right? Invite them to join. Invite them to sign up and to come in and to be a part of what's happening. And so I want to thank you, ladies. I hope you were able to disrupt some of those patterns in your life that are causing you to have that negative self-image. I hope we disrupted some of those things for you tonight. I want you to go forth. I want you to be incredible. I want you to be amazing. I want you to be fearless as well as bold, and be bold, right? Have the boldness. And I want you to meet me here next Friday. So that's what I'm going to start doing. I'm going to start Friday evenings at 6:30 Central Standard Time, just having it as a live stream where I'm coming in and I'm sharing, I'm teaching. If this information is something that you would like to continue to hear, just let me know that, right? So that I can just make sure that I'm designing topics and speaking about topics that would be of a benefit to you, okay? So ladies, have an incredible evening. Thank you guys for hanging out with Caleb and I, right? I know he kept interrupting us, but I'm so grateful that you guys understand that that's life. And, you know, he just wanted to be a part. He just wanted his attention too, okay? So, ladies, thank you. Have an awesome and incredible night and an incredible weekend. I love you guys. Bye-bye. Mwah. Bye. See you later, guys.